Hey there, Sam at Relove Guitars. This is just a quick video. I know I say quick, but it is quick compared to my 5 hour ones anyway. And in response to a couple of people who asked me about tuning guitars and said that my method of tuning, they said, one guy said, could I explain it? Because it seemed a bit like black magic when I'm tuning. So yeah, of course, and one of the reasons I don't spend a lot of time on that, I suppose, is because partly because it's one of the basic things, and I forget. It's easier to forget that it might be difficult for somebody who hasn't done it before. So I'm guilty of assuming that everybody knows it, but also partly because when you do a sort of demo on something like that, you open it in YouTube world, you tend to open yourself up for all kinds of criticism where people go, no, scientifically you can't do tuning that way because the intonation, scale length, yada da 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 da, bullshit, and so on. Yeah, some people then get really heated about it. So I'm going to preface anything I say here. Sorry, I'm wiping the board. I'm going to preface anything I say here by, this is how I do it, and it works for me, and I'm not telling anybody how to either suck eggs, as we say in England, or I'm not telling you it's the only way. But for those who asked me what the hell it is I do, here's what I do, and if it's useful, use it and do it and whatever. And if it's not useful, ignore it. But don't, please, whatever you do, don't call in and bitch about it, because it's just for fun. Anyway, is that a TV show? So here we go. So yeah, tuning. There's a couple of things about tuning, and I go over it in lots of detail in my ebook and in loads of videos. The first thing about tuning is, for me, a guitar's ability to stay and play in tune is its number one consideration, right? Everything else is secondary. There's no point having a £1,500 USA Gibson, not this, but a £1,500 USA Gibson with all the best pickups and all the pedigree and provenance and history and all of that stuff if you can't get it to get into tune, and once you've got it into tune, you can't get it to play in tune throughout your, you know, gig or your practice or your jam at home or whatever it is. If it doesn't go into tune, stay in tune and play in tune, forget it. And to me, sometimes you have to stop and really think what that means, because you and I both have played loads of guitars that do not conform to that, okay? So they fail at first most important thing. Some people think the pickup's the most important thing or the brand name, but honestly, even if you do start off believing that, right, by the time you have bought your Gibson, £1,500 Gibson, and you've played it, and if it suffers from not playing in tune, whether it's a tuning issue or whether it's a intonation issue or whatever, if the thing doesn't play and stay in tune, I promise you that's why it's on the wall, and you go to your 10 quid Westfield or whatever the hell it is you've got that plays better, right? And those people who are watching this who have a guitar like that, that should be the one they get off the wall, but they don't, right? And it will be because the one you do play seems to just, you go ding ding ding, it's in tune, you play it and it's still in tune when you put it down at the end, right? And you may not know why that is, but I guarantee you it's the one you'll go to by default, right? And so what is the point of having your £1,500 Gibson if you don't go to it because of that fundamental error, all right? So tuning is everything, right? There's no point. And if you, the other thing too, is if you're somebody who can't tell the guitar is in tune or not, then you shouldn't really be playing. No offense, I mean, you can play, and but you should take from that that if you can't tell a guitar is out of tune, then you are not at that point naturally musical, or you don't have an ear that will be conducive to you learning. Doesn't mean don't learn, but it just means you need to work on recognizing when a guitar is or isn't in tune. So I'll give you an example. I think we can all agree that isn't in tune. Okay, so that's the first hurdle. One of the things about the next thing to say about tuning is, yes, it has something to do with getting the guitar into tune, right? And that's a kind of that's a thing we do. We either use a tuner, a plug-in tuner, a clip-on tuner that goes on the end of your thing, or a little unit. Sometimes on the pickups, and there, or on your acoustic guitar, you've got a built-in tuner on your preamp and all those things. So getting it into tune is one thing, and I use, I'll go through what I use. I use either this thing here, an app, or I use a reference note off the amplifier and compare it to a note that I know needs to be an A, for example. This gives me an A. And then I tune one, and then I use a thing called relative tuning using harmonics to make sure they're all in tune with each other, and I'll go through that. But so your reference is going to be either a machine that tells you it's in tune, or it's going to be a single note, and then you tune everything, all the other strings relative to that single note. And if you use a machine to tune, you strictly speaking, you don't need to have a musical ear. If you use a relative note, you do need to be able to hear the difference between two notes when they're in and out of tune with each other. And I think using a reference point and relative tuning is really helpful to train your ear, so you can tell what's happening with the waveforms and why. You can almost visualize when they're not in tune, what's happening with the waveforms, and I'll do that in a second. But I tend to, when I'm playing with other people, I will have my tuner plugged in line so that I can constantly, or if I need to, just between songs, just check and make sure it's in tune. Now I can hear whether it's in tune or not, but I can use the tuner is there. And the good thing about that is that, of course, between songs in a band situation, you've got people talking, people drinking, people, you know, band members warming up for the next thing. So to have a visual tuner that you don't have to hear is a good idea, because you can turn your amp on to standby and you can quickly make sure you're in tune with everybody else. And the more everyone does that to the exact same standard reference point, the better the guarantee is when you kick off into the next song, you're going to be in tune. If each band member used a relative tuning method, right, the chances are high that everybody's relative tuning would be slightly different, and then you start to get a kind of a bit of a bad noise. Okay, so rewinding, before you even get into tuning your guitar, what is it that makes the guitar stay in tune, right? And there's some myths about this, and what I found only from my experience in over 300 or so setups and playing for a while, one of the myths that you need to kind of dispel, and you see it in forums all the time, people giving the sage advice. Somebody goes, I can't keep my Gibson 1500, let's imagine this Gibson that doesn't stay in tune, I can't keep my Gibson in tune, it's driving me mad. And somebody goes, change the tuners, buy a nice set of go-tos or whatever's, right? Or somebody says, I can't keep my vintage V100 in tune, buy a set of Spurtzel locking tuners, that will solve your problems. It won't. The tuning stability of a guitar has absolutely nothing, almost nothing, to do. Probably very little, next to nothing, to do with the tuning heads. I've got loads that I take off, old Chinese ones, I take off old copies and so on. I take these off for two reasons. One is I don't like the look of them. And the second reason is I don't like the gearing on them, which is a little bit sort of crude. So you kind of, you're tuning and nothing happens, and then you go up in the increments. What I want from a tuner is I want high gearing, or low. I don't know whether it's high or low, but I want like a 19:1. I don't want 14:1 gearing. I want 19:1 minimum gearing, so that I've got very progressive smooth. That makes a difference. That's why I buy new tuners. And the second one is I buy them because I like the look of them. Oh, and possibly because it's quite nice and quick and tidy to have a locking mechanism, right? So that's why I improve it. It's got nothing to do with the tuning stability, right? The tuning stability comes from two things in my experience. One, remember this, the amount of stretch left in my strings. Now, I go on about this lots in the ebook and in loads of videos. Just suffice to say, I will manually, and watch any of my videos, I will spend 20 minutes or more physically stretching the strings by the push and pull method, each string individually, right, like this, going up and down each string, including the bits either side of the nuts and the bridge. I'll do 20 minutes to half an hour of that kind of stretching to get every bit of slack out of the strings. And here's some myths. You cannot tune it up sharp and leave it overnight and it will take all the stretch out. It will not do that. You will still then bend an note years from now or a year from now, and that bit of excess force will pull out that last little bit or another bit of slack that's been waiting there, residual, and you'll be out of tune again. You'll go, oh, it's the tuners, and somebody in a forum will say, oh, it's the tuners, or it's your bridge, buy a new bridge, buy a new tuner. It's not. It's because residual slack will stay in your strings for years until you do whatever it takes. In some cases, it's a bend to physically release that slack, okay, or that stretchability. I said loads of times, I get guitars from people who've had them on the wall, and they've played them off and on for a year since they changed the strings, and they'll give them to me, and I will, first thing I'll do is I'll just go, pull it, and it'll be out of tune. Now, there's only two possible things. One is that the tune has gone backwards, and now it's out of tune, which people then go, oh, buy new tuners. Or it's that I've pulled out some residual slack that, until I put that excess pressure on, it was happy to sit there unreleased. And that's why your tuning it sharp and hanging it up overnight won't work, right? It takes physical force. And the physical force, either you do it at the beginning, like I'm telling you, or it'll happen when you're doing some groovy bend in a, you know, your two-tone bend in a Pink Floyd song, you know? And then suddenly you're out of tune and you're going ping, 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 trying to tune up in the middle of the song. So only physical force will get that slack out. And only once you've got that slack out will your strings stay in tune. That's half of the string tuning. The other half of the string tuning stability is having nut slots that do not in any way impinge or grab or hold your strings as they go through. And the amount that it takes to retard or to hold up the strings to cause tuning issues is so fine you won't even notice that it's doing it. But there is a telltale, and the telltale is the tiny little pings that you hear. I mean, it doesn't really sound quite like that, but a bit like that as you're tuning. And when I do stretching after I put new strings on, in that half an hour of stretching, tuning up, I'm constantly listening for the little pings up here. And if I find them, that means I go in with some sandpaper and I widen the slot. I don't deepen it because I've already cut it. And I always overcut the slots, but it still binds, even though I use a bigger slot, a bigger file than the actual gauge of strength. So the two enemies are binding in the nut slots and residual slack in the strings. By the way, just as another point of order, if you have pinging, people sell you all kinds of concoctions and potions to put in there, like nut sauce. It isn't. It won't work. If you have if there's a gripping of your nut, you'll put in some stuff and it will alleviate it for 5 minutes. Once that wears down, it'll still bind, right? So there's only one cure, and it's getting those widths of the slots correct first. Then add some lubricant to just make it really smooth. But don't add lubricant as an attempted solution. So those are the two enemies of tuning. And there's a third one, and you can call it intonation, you can call it tuning, whatever. And the third one is a minor one, but it's quite important. And I found it on a number of Gibsons myself, which could explain why people feel they can't get them to stay or play in tune. And that is when you have too high a first fret action. And in that case, if the slots are cut wrong here, they may be cut well so they're not binding, right? That's one of the enemies of stable tuning. But if they're too high, and this action is above 0.5 of a millimeter in my experience, you'll find that the fretting notes down here will, by definition, make the notes sharp of true, even with the lightest of touches. But the higher it is, the more sharp they'll go for even the lightest and most reasonable of fretting techniques. So, some people are counter it and go, well, you should learn how to fret. Truth is, everybody presses down with some force. And I'm just saying, the further away from 0.5 you go upwards, the more this is going to go sharp for the average player. So why go that way? Why not just cut these down to a really low action, which allows you to play comfortably and reduces vastly the likelihood. Now, I can still grab the thing and make everything go sharp if I try. That's not the point. The point is, why start from a first fret action that's going to absolutely guarantee you have intonation problems? Because what happens then is you'll tune up with your tuner, you'll have all your strings perfectly in concert pitch or whatever it's called, true. You'll fret these three on if you've got a high action, and the fretting will cause those notes to go sharp because you're having to push so far down. These first three strings will be beautifully in tune with each other, and the next three will be sharp compared to those first three, and the resultant sound will, to anyone with a musical ear, particularly an audience, will sound like crap. So so there's three things in total. The majority is your slack unreleased in your strings, takes about half an hour to physically wring it out, and if you don't do it, it'll come out some other time. The next one is your free running nut slots, and don't trust nut sauce or goop or glue or graphite or anything. Cure that first so there's no pings anywhere, and then you'll have free running strings. Then add some extra lubricant for good fun. And then the third one is a really annoying one that people always experience as tuning, and it's this high first fret action. If you take care of all of those three things really well, you will have stable tuning. Okay, so that's the whole sort of, as my kids would call it, the death lecture. I'd sit them down and make them, right, I'm going to tell you something about life. But that's the death lecture on tuning. Now, how do I tune up? Well, I think the method that people were referring to is the harmonic method, right? So on this amp, I happen to have a reference note, and it's an A, and I actually have two or three, but I only tend to use one. You have a couple of flat, double flat, so I guess that's a G. Well, that's not a tune anyway. So anyway, I have it set to A. And you could have a tuning fork like they did in the old days, and you'd dong the tuning fork and put it on your teeth or on your head, and it would suddenly sound really loud, or over your pickups. Anyway, you take your reference note and you tune your A to that. And I tend to tune the fifth fret harmonic. So the game on this is, as a musician, you need to be able to recognise when those two notes are the same or how they're different. Well, let's see if I can get this louder so you can hear. Can you hear it? Woo, 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 woo. Right? Pure tone. Beating against each other. Those two waveforms are out of sync of each other, and so they end up beating, and you can hear it. It's like if you see it in your head visually, you can time it. And you hear that ping there? I need to get in there with some... I only did that nut the other day. But hear that beating getting faster as I come closer to pitch? Faster? Sorry, as I go away from pitch. So the faster it gets, the further away from pitch I am. As I come down to pitch, it slows out. And as I get into pitch, it's almost the same. So the two waveforms have lined up, and then you know you're in pitch. And if I go below pitch, it starts beating again. Not quite so evident this time, but we're now flat. And basically, that, even if you couldn't recognize notes, you can hear that beating of the two things. And when they level out together, the two waveforms are effectively running side by side. And if you saw them side by side, they would look like that on our computer representation. When they're out of sync, one's shorter wavelength than the other, or longer, and what happens is they counteract it, or they conflict with each other. So they don't roll at the same pace as each other. One of them's going faster, and the points where they cross over makes this beating noise. So even if you're not musical, that's an A. So that's our first reference point. And you could do it on the 12th fret or the 5th, whichever you prefer, the same note. That one's an octave higher. So the 12th fret, sorry, the open string. Harmonic is an octave higher. I don't know what this one is then. technically. Yeah, be two octaves, technically speaking. So, but I tend to use the fifth, and the reason why is that the tuning, the relative tuning, happens around this position. So I get my my A string into tune. When I'm happy with that, I leave the reference tone, and then the issue here is then you can use the A string to tune the others. Now what it just means is that when your A is in tune as your new reference point, the fifth fret of the E should be the same as the A. You can hear that currently the E string is flat. Now we can either just tune it up by, I change hands because I can play the note, play the two notes together while I'm tuning. So otherwise I'm going duh, duh, duh. Right, I switch over and do this. So those two now, the E is now tuned so that at the fifth fretted, it's the same as the A. So those two are now in tune. Instead of doing it that way, we could have done it with the harmonic method, the same thing, but this time we ping the fifth on the E and the seventh on the A. And they should be the same. There's a relationship here. If you think about these things, I think this is the my goodness, those are octaves, aren't they? I don't know, that bit confuses me, but anyway, the point here is that when you're doing a tuning in a relative position, when you're fretting, E on the fifth equals the A. So if you've got your A as the given, you just want to work with your E until it becomes same as the A when you're fretting the E on the fifth. Or if you're going to use the harmonic method, the E harmonic is the same as the A seventh harmonic. So E fifth harmonic, it needs to be the same as the A. And remember, the A is the reference, so if the E isn't the same, bring the E up until those waveforms smooth out, or down until they smooth out perfectly together, and then they're the same. The fifth E, fretted fifth on the E equals the A. So we've got our bottom two in tune. You can hear that tuning relationship. Now we're going to go from the A to the D string, and we can apply the same rule, which is the fretted A on the fifth should equal the open D, which it clearly doesn't. So if I use that method again, fret the A on the fifth, open D, tune the D until they level out. Or if I want to do it using the harmonic thing, the pinged fifth should equal the pinged seventh on the D. There you go. Now the same applies again to the pinged D on the fifth should equal the G on the seventh. The bottom four strings in tune. Now this is where it changes in the harmonic pinging, and you can't use the harmonic pinging for the next strings. In the same way as that the pattern has been fifth on E equals A, fifth on A equals D, fifth on D equals G. Now we step back and it goes fourth on G should equal B. And there isn't a harmonic trick you can do with that. So at that point, people on my videos will see me go. You can hear I've got a little bit of work to do on my nut slots. So using one hand to do the same two tasks, fret the G on the fourth, play the open B, allows me to work them whilst tuning at the same time. Now that's the only one that varies from that pattern. The next one goes back to the original pattern, and we could use a harmonic. So we know that the B is now in tune. We could say that the pinged fifth on the B should be equal to the pinged seventh on the E. It's a bit flat there. Let's go above. This is a little bit harder to hear. So we could. Same waveform principle is applying, but it's harder to hear. So I tend to stick with fretted fifth, open, there we have it. So that's the harmonic method of tuning, and when you watch my videos, you'll usually see me go. Right? I could do it all the way that way. But I tend to like using the harmonics until I can't, and then I switch over to the fourth on the G equals the B. And then since I'm there, I then do the fifth on the B equals the E, and the job's done. The great thing about relative tuning is if you haven't got this note, let's imagine our note is that. Now you and I can hear those are two completely different notes, but let's say you are out on your beach with your guitar somewhere, maybe one of my lovely oak treble guitars, and that's all you've got, and there's nobody around singing notes, and you haven't got a pianist's ear, and you can't tell constant pitch, and you've got guitar out of the box, it's like that. So what you do is you pick a note and you go, well, I can't tell which is A. So you just pick one note, start with the A, I always do, and just find something you like. That'll do. Now, stupidly, still out of tune, right? Doesn't matter. I've picked that note, I'm in my hammock on the beach. Fine. So you just do the same trick using that as your reference point. This note will die away now, and you go. All around that A. In your hammock, and you're playing away. It's all fine. You don't care that you're not in tune to anything in the world. You're in tune to yourself. The about the human voice is the human voice can go any number of intervals. It doesn't have any intervals. It can go anywhere you like. So if your notes begin there, you can go, there is a house in New Orleans, they call the rising sun. Sounds fine, apart from my singing, but it's been around with many poor boys, God, I know I'm one. So if you're around the campfire on your, you know, your camping trip or your holiday or wherever you are, away from civilization in any proper concert pitch tones, you're internally in tune, right? You've picked a reference note that you are happy with, doesn't really matter what it is, and you've tuned the rest of the guitar to that. Yes, it's completely out of tune with every guitar in the world, and the concert piano just ran behind that bush just over there. But the point is, you can entertain and entertain yourself and others. Itself. So that's relative tuning, how to tune it to a pitch, but also relative tuning, how to tune it relatively within any note within the guitar without having any concern about what the reference note is. And you can just do it if the guitar goes out of tune and you need to get it back in tune. Same thing again. That's really quick and you could tinker around and get it a little bit more precise. But the point is, it doesn't really matter. Oh, and then you get back to civilization and somebody goes, no, that's an A. Oh, I was flat all along. Now I'm in tune. So the good thing about being able to tune relatively is if, let's say you're playing along with, I don't think I've probably got anything, but let's say you, oh, I'm going to get sued for copyright if I play anything, but let's say you're playing along, you put on a video or something and you're playing along with an old song from the 80s, all you have to do really is, or you want to practice something but you've got a video and you play a note and it's not in tune, you can hear the guitar's not in tune, all you need to do is find a note that is in tune. So I wish I could give you a live example. Let's see if I can in a minute. Probably all of this stuff will be concert pitch if it's modern. I don't have a lot of music on here actually. Let's find something old that I know is out of tune. Come on. Playlist. Okay, I might find one that's out of tune. Okay, I know this one's way out of tune. Sorry. It's not that far out of tune, actually. Okay, but you can hear it is a little bit. So that's out of tune, right? So what I do is you take your G note and then you just play that note until that one note sounds in tune with your song that you want to play along with. Then you tune everything else to that one string that you just tuned to. It doesn't even have to be an open string. I'm trying to find something that's definitely out of tune and I can't find it. Okay, this is Jumping Jack Flash by the Rolling Stones. Sorry about copyright. Okay, here we go. It's supposed to be in B, right? There's B. So you can hear that my guitar is sharp. So all you need to do is change the B. When you think you've got a B matching that, now we'll tune to the B as the reference point. Then we'll use the B as the reference point still. Down with the G. Using the G now, so I'm moving back this way. Turn the D down. And we should then end up with. Okay, so go away, don't want to get sued. Right, anyway, the point being is, that's how you would tune relatively to a song, which can be really annoying if you're trying to learn something and it's from the 60s or something, and it's clearly going to be, well, it may well have been out of tune to begin with, because they may have tuned relatively in the studio, or they may have tuned to somebody's tuning fork, or they may have just picked up someone's guitar and everyone tuned to that. Alternatively, it's probably did begin with an organ note or a piano note as a reference, or a ping tuning fork, but what's happened since then is that it's been recorded obviously on tape, and then the tape has been speeded up, slowed down, because it's mechanical and there's no absolutes to how fast or how slow it goes over the years. Maybe that tape was put on a different machine later on, it runs a little bit faster, and the result is that it often old songs are never in tune. So if you want to play along with them, you need to identify, pick a note that you can pick out in the song, tune your guitar so that you can hear that note is in tune, and then once you've got that, that string becomes your reference point for relative tuning, and then you can play along with the song. Obviously, you've got to go back to the original reference when you want to play with other people. So there you go. I can get this oversized plug out of this hole. So there you go. That's my little tuning thing. It went on longer than I expected, but there's always interesting things to say. So there you go. I hope that was useful. If it wasn't, please don't tell me how unscientific that method is. It's perfectly good enough to play along with yourself, to entertain yourself. I don't recommend using, as I said, the relative tuning harmonic method for playing with other people, because it's quite subjective. But the interesting bit, as you can probably tell, if I just use the yonder whiteboard for a second, when you hear the notes beating, what you're getting is you're getting, let's say that's the waveform represented by a pure A. What you're hearing with the notes beating against each other is that you're hearing another note that's got a longer waveform that's going like this. Okay, and it doesn't. They don't sit spoon-like together, and so what you're getting is this sort of jarring point where they don't match. Okay. And when you get it right, they obviously work together. But the great thing about those jarring points is that you can hear it. It tells you, and the closer you get to tune, the further apart those points become, until eventually your waveforms on your two strings that you're playing together match perfectly, and they run alongside each other with exactly the same frequency. And so the kind of pitch, I think, is dictated by the width of this wavelength. Is it wavelength? Yeah, the wavelength. And if when they're the same wavelength, they're playing the same note, and you don't hear any beating because they're in sync with each other. It's only when this one, and sometimes you can get things that where then they're kind of halfway between each other, when they really are kind of wah 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 wah, and you can hear all those beating points. And that's what you hear, all that speeding up or slowing down. And as we stretch this waveform down to meet this, or up to meet it, what happens is that, it's probably not a very good explanation, but that those points where it conflicts are kind of ironed out, and they kind of work together. Okay. And in fact, it works even when they are multiples of each other. So it's bizarre that if you were to do an octave higher and the next note was twice this, they still fit into the same shape, bizarrely. I don't quite know how that works, but let's not go there. It's all science, ain't it? Okay, so I hope that The bit that matters really is not the whiteboard. The bit that matters is what your ears tell you about the conflict, and you can just use that beating to watch it iron out into that beautiful sort of smooth thing where you know it's in tune, and then you've got your reference point. Hope that was useful. See you again soon.